Whether it's a hot time in Florida
or a rainy night in Georgia,
looking for trouble?
It's the perfect time for the TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis fan podcast.
Oh, yes, sir. Good season opened up for this bad fix spring. He's the hottest thing in the country. Real hot and blue. Coming to WHB in Memphis, Tennessee.
With your hosts, Justin Gosman and Gurdeep Ladar.
The TCB Cast is on the air.
Welcome to TCBCast, an unofficial Elvis Presley fan podcast. I'm Justin Gosman, and today you're getting something very special. On November 22nd, 1961, 60 years ago to the day from the release of this podcast, the Paramount film Blue Hawaii was released into theaters. Its soundtrack album had already released 1 month prior, on October 20th, and both the album and film were destined to become among the most commercially successful and well-loved of all 31 narrative feature films to star Elvis Presley. In 2016, I started a web series on YouTube called Blue Suede Reviews, where I would look at each of Elvis's films in chronological order, but due to extenuating circumstances, stopped just after completing the review of 1960's Flaming Star. Over the past 5 years, even through TCBCast's run, I had received countless requests from viewers asking me to bring the series back, and at the beginning of this year, I had the opportunity to do so through launching our Patreon. Except, as you will hear, I did more than just bring it back. I have been creating essentially monthly, feature-length documentaries, not only analyzing each film, but thoroughly examining how they were made, who the creative teams were that made them, and what their intentions were. They also look at cultural context and frequently touch on the history around locations, cultures, public figures, social movements, the state of the entertainment industry, and other films, plays, music, and entertainers. It is at once a celebration, a study, and a critique of Elvis's time in Hollywood, so often written off by biographers. I have only been able to do this thanks to the support of our patrons. Their support has afforded me the time and resources necessary to do the history behind these movies justice. Among all of the projects and the writing that I have done over the years, the work that I've done on Blue Suede Reviews this year, and especially this episode on Blue Hawaii, is among that which I am most proud. And I hope that you learn something new, or find a way to think about this film, which is so often overlooked, even by the most ardent Elvis fans, as brainless fluff, in a very different light. As of this month, I am in the process of completing the review of Kissing Cousins, and will be at approximately the halfway point of Elvis's film career. I fully intend on completing the remaining reviews, and then I plan to go back and rewrite, expand, and re-edit the original 6 reviews from scratch to bring them up to the same level of depth and detail as the new ones have been. But that will only be possible with continued support. I'm incredibly grateful that as of right now, I will be able to continue producing these monthly for the foreseeable future. But if you enjoy this and you want to hear more and support the production of additional essays like this, I encourage you to consider supporting TCBCast at patreon.com/TCBCast if you can afford to. Now, please set your mind back to 1961. There are a lot of places in time where you could begin the story of the origins of 1961's Blue Hawaii. But perhaps the most pivotal moment came in the fall of 1958, just around the time the United States Army shipped Private Presley off to Germany. Amid Colonel Parker's tough negotiation tactics with 20th Century Fox and Paramount for Elvis's return to cinema, Parker made the unusual decision to pitch a story for an Elvis film to producer Hal Wallace, and it was this. Set against the backdrop of Hawaii, a gang of shady record promoters would follow a famous singer and surreptitiously create bootleg recordings of his performances alongside native Hawaiians, exploiting both the Hawaiian musicians and the protagonist, who, naturally, would be tasked with putting an end to the con with all the action, romance, scenery, and songs that you would expect walking into an Elvis Presley picture. Although Hal Wallace knew Parker meant well, acting upon that old adage, write what you know, the showbiz story wasn't exactly what Wallace had in mind for Elvis's next film for Paramount. But he had to admit, there might be something to that Hawaii thing. And this pitch is what set in motion the wheels for writer Alan Weiss, an associate of Wallace's, to begin crafting his first real Hollywood story. Beach Boy, it would be titled. Before screenwriter Hal Cantor, who had directed 1957's Loving You, fleshed it out into the feature-length Hawaiian Beach Boy. With Flaming Star out before Christmas 1960 and with Wild in the Country set to release that June, it's interesting that in February 1961, at a press conference in Memphis, prompted about what type of role he enjoys playing the most in his films, Elvis said this.
Well, I would like to play a dramatic role, but I don't, I'm not ready for that either, really. I haven't had enough experience in acting. And again, until I'm ready for it, it would be foolish to undertake something very dramatic.
This is interesting because months before anyone could even make a judgment call on Wild in the Country, Elvis had already begun to internalize a sort of self-doubt about his capabilities as an actor. Elvis answers the follow-up question about his more musical films with this statement.
Well, probably so. I mean, actually, I slept up to the studio mostly. But you can rest assured that it'll be music in almost all of them.
There has to be. The disappointment in Elvis's voice is palpable, and it's clear that a sort of disillusionment has hit Elvis. The conventionally accepted narrative about Elvis's time in Hollywood claims that the poor box office of the two dramas back-to-back were what caused Elvis to end up in the more commercially appealing escapist romantic comedies that more closely followed the formula that had been established years earlier for other actor-singers. Director Norman Torog, whom Wallace was tapping again for this film, was almost the go-to man for this type of movie. He directed Dean Martin in a half-dozen romantic comedies the previous decade, Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland in several in the 1940s, and if you went back further to the golden age of the 30s, Torog had even made a couple films just like these with Bing Crosby. We're Not Dressing, where Bing played a singing sailor, and Rhythm on the Range as a singing cowboy. Bing Crosby. Those are the magic words to unlocking a deeper understanding of how Elvis's film career came about. It's worth taking a moment to briefly examine Bing because you don't get to Elvis and you quite literally don't get to Blue Hawaii without Bing Crosby.
Night and you and blue Hawaii. The night is heavenly and you are heaven to me.
Bing Crosby, born Harry Crosby Jr. in 1903, was, as a boy, given his distinctive, unusual nickname by a friendly neighbor as a cute reference to comic strip The Bingville Bugle, which the young Crosby loved to read. Always in love with music, Bing bounced from band to band and coast to coast, paying his dues before finally hitting it big as the lead singer of the Rhythm Boys and spinning off his own solo career. His warm, baritone vocal with its nuanced stylings coupled with sheer charisma and dashing looks made him an international star on the radio, on records, at the cinema, and later on television. He is, to this day, among the most influential and beloved artists of the 20th century, of whose filmographies and discographies spanned a dizzying array of genres and styles. He was also, just to note, a mean alcoholic who at times was physically and emotionally abusive towards his sons, in the way that many of his generation unfortunately were, as reported by his son Gary Crosby, who would star with Elvis in 1965's Girl Happy. In between the Great Depression and World War II, though, Bing Crosby movies were great escapism for the masses, but it was 1937's Waikiki Wedding that introduced the song Blue Hawaii into the pop culture lexicon.
In blue Hawaii, and mine could all come true. This magic night of nights with you.
The gist of Waikiki Wedding's plot is that advertising agent Tony Marvin, played by Bing, has come up with a marketing campaign for a local pineapple company in Hawaii. A handpicked, quote, pineapple girl will be whisked away for a romantic 3-week vacation in the territory of Hawaii and then publish her enthusiastic opinions in print, thereby generating public interest both in Hawaii and the company's products. It's quite literally the 1930s equivalent of a sponsored social media influencer. Shirley Ross's character, a small-town gal named Georgia Smith, gets picked, but when she arrives, she views Hawaii as a place where people simply live and work.
You pardon me? Oh, yes, here's where we left off. To me, the place is just Birch Falls with a lot of palm trees stuck in it.
Well, what about your great idea man now?
Where is he? Get him!
To amp up her Hawaiian adventure, Tony is forced to romance her, and they set off following an exotic mystery surrounding a black pearl involving tribes of indigenous Hawaiians. In typical rom-com tradition, Tony ends up getting a conscience about the whole thing after he sincerely falls for Georgia. The plot's fairly thin, primarily intended as a showcase for Hawaiian-flavored song and dance sequences, but for someone who's a fan of Elvis's films, it's immediately, strikingly familiar in terms of tone and structure to the most formulaic of the Elvis Presley vehicles. And at times, it's very easy to imagine swapping the Elvis Presley of Blue Hawaii and the Bing Crosby of Waikiki Wedding and not missing a beat.
Leilani,
Leilani,
heavenly flower, I dreamed of paradise for
Waikiki Wedding itself was intended to drum up some interest in the seemingly exotic culture of Hawaii. Itself not yet even a state, but more within the means of Middle America than more distant destinations. But on December 7th, 1941, a U.S. naval base in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii was the target of surprise military attack by Japanese forces, thrusting America into World War II, and any serious thoughts people had about luxury tourism there evaporated.
A date which will live in infamy.
The attack on Pearl Harbor brings us back to Elvis in the spring of 1961. Because Waikiki Wedding had been a Paramount film, the rights to Blue Hawaii were easily obtained as an homage to the earlier film, and so the film was retitled, and between wrapping the soundtrack sessions for Blue Hawaii on March 23rd and commencing filming on March 27th, Elvis gave a live performance at the Block Arena in Pearl Harbor as a charity benefit to help raise the remaining money needed to push a memorial for the victims of the attack just over the point where construction could get underway. The concert, preserved on an amateur tape, is absolutely electric and captures Elvis doing many of his songs in the original style they were recorded, including a handful he never performed again in concert, such as A Fool Such As I Need Your Love Tonight, and Swing Down Sweet Chariot.
I have been waiting just for a night.
The fundraiser brought in over $60,000, equivalent to well over $500,000 today. The construction on the memorial was able to be finished by the end of 1961, and it remains open some 60 years later. Elvis didn't know it would be his last live performance for nearly 7 years. In fact, in an interview afterward with Hawaii-based DJ Tom Moffat, Elvis expressed a hope that residents who had missed the show would get a chance to see him again at a future show in Hawaii. They eventually would get that chance over a decade later, and the audience for that show would be much, much larger. But for all the wild raucousness of the weekend, Elvis's name was on the call sheet for Blue Hawaii. Filming started on Monday, and you could rest assured that there'd be music in it. There had to be.
You want to tell us about Blue Hawaii a bit, the content of the story?
That's a story about a boy who just got out of the Army. That's a coincidence.
Yeah.
And he's in love with this girl, this Hawaiian girl, and his parents don't go for him because they're high class. And but it gets all involved, and there's about 11 songs in it.
Yeah. And some Hawaiian tunes.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
We're doing a Hawaiian wedding song, Hawaiian sunset, and Blue Hawaii.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You got some special material written for you for the picture?
Yeah. We had about 10 songs written especially for the picture.
Blue Hawaii opens with a beautiful Technicolor montage of on-location footage set to Elvis's version of the title song, and we're quickly introduced to Miley Duval, a French-Hawaiian young woman played by Joan Blackman, racing to the local airport on Oahu to pick up her boyfriend Chadwick Gates as he returns from his time in Europe serving in the U.S. Army. A story that sounds a little familiar. Along the way, she's stopped by an officer for speeding, but when she informs him of her reason for going so fast, the officer excitedly gives her an escort. Before we even see him, we know that Chad is well-loved on the islands, to comedic levels. Our first sight of Chad, though, is him making out with one of the airline attendants, and although she is jealous, Chad manages to win Miley back over with his charm and playfully sings to her about his overseas antics and how he was almost always true to her.
Met a pretty mademoiselle, her papa owned a small hotel.
Mademoiselle, small hotel, Nick.
Oh, I was almost always true to you.
Chad convinces her to take him to a beach shack shared by him and his old buddies to relax for a while, despite Miley's attempts to remind him of his responsibilities to his wealthy parents, who expect him to come home and get involved in the pineapple company operated by his father. But after time away, Chad has realized he doesn't want to live out someone else's plan for him. He wants to go his own way.
All the time I was overseas, I got a letter from my folks every week reminding me of my beautiful home and my beautiful future and my dad's beautiful pineapple business. And the more they reminded me, the more I knew I couldn't come back here with the rest of my life all laid out for me.
Chad's Hawaiian friends, who work as a local band, show up while the couple is swimming, and Chad cheerfully joins them in song, while Miley struggles after losing the top to her new two-piece European-style bathing suit called a bikini.
Come to me, let's be sweethearts again, and then let us part no more.
Hey, Miley, come on in, will ya?
Not yet!
A few days later, after being confronted by Chad's father, Fred Gates, played by Roland Winters, Miley convinces Chad to return home to see his parents, who are playing host to the Southern Hawaiian Fruit Company's top executive, Jack. Chad relents and returns home, only to be harassed by his mother, Sarah Lee, an over-the-top, ignorant, wannabe socialite portrayed hilariously on point by Angela Lansbury, as she begins to plan a welcome home party for Chad and lays out her demands that he must put away his ambitions and act more like a person of the higher social, economic, and racial class that she believes her family to be a part of.
Now, Chadwick, we might as well have an understanding right off. You've come home to stay, and your life's gonna be different. You're gonna associate yourself with the finer elements on this island. And you're gonna have a responsible position with a great Southern Hawaiian Fruit Company. And you're gonna marry a girl of your own class and be a gentleman like your daddy.
Frustrated, Chad leaves and heads to Miley's grandmother's 78th birthday party, where he receives a more welcome reception by her family and gives her grandmother a music box he picked up in Austria.
Thank you. The light you kindle in my granddaughter's eye is gift enough.
It's a music box. It plays a European love song, but they're the same in any language.
During a picnic the next day at a scenic overlook, Chad confesses to Miley that he feels Hawaii is in a process of growing, what with all the tourists coming to the islands, and he wants to become a part of the excitement on his own, rather than on his parents' terms.
Hawaii has a big future. I want to become a part of it. I'm young, healthy, I'm not too stupid.
Well, wonderful.
Well, this place is growing by leaps and bounds. There are more tourists come here than any other state in the Union. Hey, that's it. I'm glad you thought of it.
What'd I think of?
Tourist business. Your business. It's booming, isn't it?
It's getting bigger all the time.
Well, I know every inch of these islands. I'd make a good tourist guide.
You'd make a great tourist guide. I'll put a word in with my boss.
Oh, no, you don't. I'll put him on word. Now, this mission is strictly solo. Here.
You're coming in loud and proud.
I gotta get going. I gotta see your boss. I've wasted too much time already.
Mr. Chapman is a pretty forgetful boss, but Chad, having grown up on the islands, passes his quiz about the best sights and spots in Hawaii, so he gets a job working with a new client, a schoolteacher named Abigail Prentice. Miley and Chad go to meet her, but are surprised to learn that she is a beautiful single woman rather than the stereotypical elder matron schoolteacher they expected. Abigail informs them she's chaperoning four teenage girls, and there's some fun innuendo in the back and forth between them.
Frankly, Miss Duvall, I was expecting an older man.
Miss Prentice, as part of the service, I promise to get a little older every day.
Of course, if you would prefer another guide, I'm sure that the office could arrange it for you, Miss Prentice. We'd like to keep our customers perfectly satisfied.
Mr. Gates, do you think you can satisfy a schoolteacher and four teenage girls?
Oh, I'll sure try, ma'am. I'll do all I can.
Surely the audience members are the ones with the dirty minds, right? Ultimately, Abigail is impressed with Chad and agrees to allow him to serve as their tour guide. After a brief stopover at his parents' welcome home party, where Chad and Miley are rescued by the band following some of Sara Lee's intimidation tactics toward Miley, they meet up with Abigail and the young women the next morning, and Chad sets out with them toward a pineapple plantation, introducing to some Hawaiian phrases and factoids.
Okay. And what's your name, little girl?
You may call me Miss Corbett.
La-di-da-da.
Well, Miss Corbett, you might be interested to know that since 1778, we've been welcoming Malahinis from all over the world.
Welcoming what?
Malahinis. That's us.
I thought we were Wahinis.
You're both. Malahini means newcomers. Wahini means female.
What do you know? We're Wahini Malahinis.
Big deal.
One of the teenagers, Ellie, has a bit of an attitude problem, having been sent away on the trip by her rich but negligent parents. And although Chad tries to extend an olive branch, well, pineapple, she treats him with disdain, but finds herself quickly attracted to the much older Chad due to his having given her any attention at all. Later, at the Hukilau, a group fishing activity, Ellie attempts to seduce Chad, but he sees her for what she is and humorously deflects her.
Did you ever see anything like this in a cradle?
Come here, Ellie. Hold out your arms. Now close your little eyes. Take this to Ito.
After dinner, everyone has some fun laughing, singing, and dancing at the expense of Chad's voracious friend Ito and just enjoying the festive atmosphere.
Everything, he don't care what, he even eat the shell from the coconut.
Eat, eat, don't eat all the night and the day. Eat, eat, don't eat all the night and the day.
The plot picks up later with Chad coming down to breakfast and revealing to his parents that he's taken up the tour guide job, which sets Sara Lee off. But in a nice moment, Jack reminds her that her own husband used to be nothing more than a simple worker as well.
I don't know. When you married Fred, he was just a chauffeur, driving bananas around in my old truck. I'd rather drive girls than bananas any day.
We rejoin Chad and the women later that evening at a luau, where a loud, obnoxious, and drunken tourist named Mr. Garvey begins hitting on Ellie, who flirts with the older man in an attempt to rile Chad up, while Garvey's wife Enid tries to get Chad to dance with her herself. When it's clear that Garvey isn't going to let up, a fight breaks out, and the police are inevitably called in. We see Chad and his buddies, who were playing at the luau, in jail singing Beach Boy Blues, still in their costumes from the night before, still holding onto their instruments while in the slammer. It's so absurd, played completely for laughs, and honestly, it works.
Got those Beach Boy Blues. Don't the time go slow? Lonely Beach Boy Blues. Only 30 days and 90 years to go.
Chad gets bailed out by his father and is fired from his job by Chapman, who is worried about the reputation of his tour company and demands payback of the damages to the luau. Miley, however, stands up for him, and when Chapman won't back down, she quits on the spot. Back at home, Sara Lee tries to pin the blame for the whole situation on Chad's friends, and when Chad tries to stand up to his parents, his father lays down his own expectations. He let Chad try it his way, and it failed. Now he has to try things on their terms if he plans on staying in their house. Chad, without a thought, walks out.
What did we do wrong?
Offhand, I'd say we got married.
Miley and Chad brainstorm what to do next, and Chad gets inspired to start up his own tour company, starting with Abigail and the girls, who haven't left yet, but canceled their tour with Chapman after learning that Chad had been fired. Miley agrees to handle the bookings, and we soon catch up with Chad and the women arriving at a resort in Kauai, riding horses across the landscapes of the island before arriving just back in time to catch the pre-dinner fire-twirling show.
Pretty impressive, huh?
Indeed.
It's beautiful. Wow.
Miley arrives on Kauai with Jack, intending to surprise Chad, and Jack notes that he's got business on the island as well, but doesn't let on what exactly his business is. Late that night, Ellie sneaks into Chad's room in yet another attempt to seduce him, but the other girls come looking for her, and then Abigail comes to confess that she's also fallen in love with someone. The implication, which Ellie picks up on, of course, is that it's Chad, and Miley passes by, spotting Abigail and Chad talking in his room, making her jealous as well. Upset over her rejection, Ellie steals their Jeep and drives off, running it off the road near a downed tree branch, giving Chad just enough time to catch up to her. She runs out into the ocean in an attempt to kill herself, but Chad stops her and tells her that she needs to learn the lesson that he learned. Stop pretending to be something you're not.
If you like yourself, others will like you too.
There's nothing to like.
There's a lot to like if you wouldn't try to be something you're not. It don't work, I know. You better find out now and save yourself a lot of grief.
Ellie's not a mature woman, she's a girl. And Chad's not high class. That was just a lie. He's nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time.
I got a feeling this is going to make both of us an awful lot better.
I'm not apologizing for that. Chad's treatment apparently works, and Ellie straightens out, but Miley is still suspicious of Chad. It's not until Jack arrives and reveals that the person Abigail has fallen for, off-screen, is him, not Chad, that things begin to clear up.
You and Jack?
Yes!
Congratulations to both of you. Great. It's just great.
Look, fella, I've got my girl. What I just saw of yours, I'd say you've got a few things to straighten out.
Well, where'd she go?
Last time I saw her, she's headed for a bungalow. Oh, I missed you.
It's great. You don't know how great it is.
Jack gets Chad and Miley together with Fred to clear the air, and Chad unveils that his plan is to open a tour company with Miley, but work with the fruit company to bring in their executives and salesmen on resort holidays and tours so they'll be more encouraged to do well. Chad slyly proposes to Miley, which she accepts, and in our final scene, they're married in a large-scale Hawaiian wedding set to music, and it's a happily ever after ending for everyone.
Yeah, I marry her. That's
you do.
That's where we use Hawaiian wedding song.
Oh,
it's the very last scene of the picture. In fact, we're doing it next week. And what's the name of the place?
Kauai.
Yeah.
Despite its lightweight plot, Blue Hawaii is an interesting beast of a film. What I glossed over is that of its 101-minute runtime, by my count, over 29 minutes are purely music and dance numbers. And that's not counting all the setup and wind-down for the songs either, but strictly where the needle dropped and got picked up, so to speak. It offers far and away the highest ratio of musical sequences to plot of any movie in the Elvis canon. And quantity-wise, only Girls, 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 the second film in the Hal Wallace and Elvis Hawaii trilogy, as I call it, comes anywhere close. It would be difficult for any movie executive or critic to make an argument that Elvis couldn't carry a film as a top performer when it's his vocal cords and sheer on-screen presence primarily holding it all together, helped along with some absolutely stunning scenery of real-life Hawaii. Because most of Blue Hawaii was shot on location, Hal Wallace and Norman Torog brought Academy Award-winning Charles Lang back behind the camera as cinematographer. Lang's framing in his last Elvis film, Loving You, had stuck out as one of the strongest technical points of that film, and he was given a veritable smorgasbord of options to take advantage of in scenic Hawaii. Anywhere he pointed the camera was sure to be spectacular. Editor Terry Morse has shots linger on mountain ranges, sandy beaches, and deep blue water when they could have very easily been snipped for time, and the highly saturated Technicolor treatment captures a vibrancy of not only natural Hawaii, but also Edith Head's costume design that gives the film a dreamy look. Torog even managed to avoid featuring Hawaii's notorious tropical rain too often, giving the perception of a picture-perfect image more likely seen in a Hawaiian tourism ad than the real experience. And that really gets down to it, doesn't it? Blue Hawaii presents an idealized Hawaiian vacation from Middle America, a curated Disneyland experience with Elvis Presley as your personal guide. At its most egregious, Chad and his guests stop to watch an entire minute and a half long fire twirling routine, which Chad eloquently describes this way.
That's the traditional Hawaiian way of announcing the chow's on.
The sequence does nothing for the plot, doesn't provide any insights regarding our characters, the actors aren't even in the same physical space as the performers. Don't think, just sit back, maw gaping, eyes wide in amazement, and don't forget to order a drink.
Pretty impressive, huh?
Indeed. It's beautiful.
Shall we, ladies?
Yes.
Blue Hawaii was massively successful. It was in the top 20 grossing films of both 1961 and 1962. The accompanying soundtrack album spent 20 weeks, almost 5 months, at number one. Despite Blue Hawaii being unquestionably one of the most singularly popular and influential pieces of work Elvis Presley did in his entire career, mainstream rock critics have dismissively made Blue Hawaii out as something for not only Elvis to be embarrassed by, but for Elvis's quote-unquote true fans to be personally embarrassed by as well, rather than as an object worthy of study or examination. Even Peter Guralnick's Careless Love, often posed as the definitive biography of Elvis's life, dismisses the film, writing, quote, "One feels for him. One squirms with an embarrassment of one's own as he is asked to stand still for the trivialization of his music, as he is forced to publicly repudiate his commitment to rock and roll." Blue Hawaii is so often depicted as the most ruinous of all of Elvis Presley's films and soundtracks because of what its success led to, while simultaneously it's one of the most beloved. And yet, even Elvis fans who love the film, who love Elvis's films generally, are also guilty of reminding critics that you're just supposed to enjoy it, not think about it. From both lovers and haters, the message is the same. It's not worth looking under the surface of Blue Hawaii. But I pose this question: if his most commercially successful feature film and album are not worth analyzing, what else did Elvis do that is? I want to use Guralnick's quote as a basis for my look at Elvis's Chad Gates. It's a given that Elvis is charming in the role, that his performance holds the film together, but why do so many fans view it as a repudiation of his image as a rocker? Let's take a look at Elvis's protagonists thus far. I know there's a lot, but I think it's worth going through to prove the point. Please indulge me. You have Clint Reno, a farmer's son on an operation so poor his brothers feel they have to steal to support it. Deke Rivers, a scrappy orphan whose most optimistic dream before stardom is to maybe own a farm. Vince Everett, a laborer with a rap sheet who gets a lucky break. Danny Fisher, a street-smart high school dropout who gets in deep with a mobster. Tulsa McLean, a soldier with a dream of owning a nightclub. Pacer Burton, a farmer's son caught between a conflict of culture on the frontier. And Glenn Tyler, a farmer's son who has to be convinced that higher education is even within his reach. Here in Blue Hawaii, we have Chadwick Gates, son of a wealthy plantation executive, whose primary dilemma is one of privilege. He is wealthy, and his only goal is to not have his life plans be so easy. And yet he has a leg up over almost everyone else on the island before the film even begins. His own mother views his military service as a waste of time and tries to delude herself into thinking Chad fought in the war to have made it worthwhile.
Sara Lee, how many times do I have to tell you he was not in a war?
Oh, I know you're right, Daddy, but if I don't tell myself there was a war, I have a most depressing feeling Chadwick's just wasted 2 years.
At face value, Chad Gates is supposed to be someone that the audience can relate to. We're meant to put ourselves in his shoes and pat ourselves on the back. Yes, we are pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps as well. Chad gets it. All he wants is to be a man of the people. For the first time, Elvis Presley, so often viewed as a blue-collar American icon, is playing a rich boy, rejecting the white collar, apparently. But Chad's character arc in the film, on paper, is ultimately about a wealthy inheritor who does, in fact, put down childish things, just as his mama told him to, and gets inspired to start his own tour business, whose clientele will be the rich executives and salesmen from his father's company.
But I think I figured a way to do both. Work for the Great Southern Hawaiian Fruit Company and Chad Gates. How many salesmen do you have, Jack?
Well, I don't
317.
Know. Scattered all over the states, right?
Mm-hmm. And Canada.
And every year you have your annual sales meeting in Atlanta. They all come, don't they?
Most all.
Now, have you ever thought of how much they would look forward to a trip to Hawaii? You could bring them over here, show them how we grow the fruit, process it, let them get a first-hand taste of Hawaiian sunshine, and then go back to their territories and sell like they never sold before.
Fred, I think the boy's got something.
And also special incentive trips. Any salesman who goes over his quota, he gets a week's holiday here, all expenses paid.
Why, that's a crackerjack notion. I'll put you in charge of the whole program.
No, I don't want that, Jack. I want to go into business for myself, with Miley. Now, that's my Declaration of Independence.
I wondered where I fit into this.
Where will he get the money to start his tour agency? One guess. When young Ellie, the rebellious teen, runs off and Chad tracks her down, rather than convincing her with words, treating her like the individual she is, and helping her through her immature worldview, Chad spanks her. Wow, what a rebel.
All right, Eleanor. If that'll prove that somebody does care...
You wouldn't dare!
Wouldn't I dare, wouldn't I? I got a feeling this is going to make both of us an awful lot better.
Despite a vague reference to Chad being born in Georgia and Sarah Lee's constant posturing as a Southern belle, all the things most closely associated with the image of Elvis Presley is either gone or has its edges rounded off. His Southernness, his musical heritage of country, gospel, rock. What passes for blues here is even played for laughs. That isn't to say this is inherently bad. After all, the profession is acting, pretending to be someone or something other than yourself. But I think there's often a practice, rightly or wrongly, of viewing the roles that Elvis played as reflections of himself, rather than self-contained identities off the pages of a script. And the more thinly drawn they were, the easier it was for both Elvis fans and critics to just say, Elvis did this, Elvis did that, in regards to actions his character takes on screen. And to have a role where Elvis played a character that represented the establishment symbolically spoke volumes. To be fair, this sort of conflation was not uncommon in the era. One needs to only look at John Wayne to see period examples of performers being identified by their persona first and as a character second. But as I've said before on Blue Suede Reviews, I do think it's unfair to Elvis to allow the symbolism to overtake the individual, to put him in a box where his only options are apparently a farmer's son who sings or a farmer's son who sings, just not as much. Despite the role being out of his milieu thus far, there was very little in the script to challenge Elvis dramatically. But as Chad Gates, Elvis does manage to make an unrelatable and unlikable protagonist appealingly charming. And part of that success was the strength of his supporting performers selling their roles as well.
I stayed away from drinking wine, thought about you all the time.
Drinking wine all the time, you...
Oh. I was almost always true to you.
Ah! Elvis spends most of the movie playing opposite Joan Blackman's Miley Duvall, in a role originally considered for G.I. Blues' Juliet Prowse, until a dispute over her bringing a makeup artist from another studio got her replaced. Elvis and Joan have a warm chemistry in their scenes together. Some critics have characterized it as more of a sibling vibe, but the script pretty clearly lays out that they're longtime lovers, so comfortable together that they're almost already married as it is. Miley is written as the ideal woman of her generation. She's smarter than Chad, an entrepreneurial member of the workforce, and she also serves as the perfect excuse for the filmmakers to introduce the cutting-edge two-piece bathing suit bikini to moviegoers. In 1961, still in its transition from a scandalous and indecent novelty, see Itsy Bitsy Teeny Weeny Polka Dot Bikini, to common beach attire. The script makes a show of depicting Miley as relatively progressive, but also has her melting over Chad despite his clearly obvious womanizing. It's not a perfectly written role, but she does well. Miley is also intended to be half French and half Hawaiian, which at the very least a well-tanned Joan Blackman passes for more in 1961 than Julia Prowse would have, though it does raise an eyebrow as to whether this was done to make sure all the real-world Sarah Lee Gates of the 1960s weren't too up in arms about Elvis playing a character who was doing any race mixing.
Oh, he's talked about you, too. Oh, yes, we both talked about you.
Yes.
Speaking of which, beloved British actress Angela Lansbury commits to her role 110% and steals very nearly every scene she is in, hemming it up with a southern accent, playing up the vile racism and classism spewed by Sarah Lee Gates to the zany level intended so that it comes all the way back around to endearing.
Company. And you're going to marry a girl of your own class and be a gentleman like your daddy.
Mom, do we have to discuss this now?
Yes, I don't want you wasting your precious time on those beach boys or that native girl.
Sarah Lee, the boy just came home.
She knows exactly what type of movie she's in, and she has no qualms about it. It's arguably not been since King Creole's Walter Matthau that Elvis played opposite a strong performer who pushes back. And there remains in the film a number of shots where it's obvious Elvis is having a hard time keeping a straight face while Lansbury hams it up. Despite being a mere 10 years older than Elvis, with makeup, hair, and attitude, she convincingly pulls off the difference in age and perspective. The lead male performers, Roland Winters as Fred Gates and Howard McNear as Mr. Chapman, were both character actors, and Winters plays the perfect straight man to Angela Lansbury, with his deadpan line deliveries often leading straight into well-timed double takes from her. McNear, most famous as Floyd the Barber from The Andy Griffith Show, is typecast as the forgetful neurotic, which could be criticized as one note, but he appears in the film just long enough to elicit some laughs, but not long enough to let the bit get tired.
Is it anything to do with Chad?
Chad who?
Chad Gates. Remember?
Oh, say, he's a fine-looking boy. He's bright, too. We should hire him.
He's been working for you for 2 days. He's the guide for Miss Prentice and the girls.
A girl.
Of the five women Chad is assigned to take around the islands, he spends the most time with Nancy Walters as the teacher Abigail Prentice and Jenny Maxwell as Ellie Corbett. The three other young women, Beverly, Patsy, and Sandy, played by Christian Kay, Darlene Tompkins, and Pamela Austin respectively, aren't drawn with any meaningful depth. They're present more to serve as the audience's stand-ins as wide-eyed mainlanders, amazed by the exotic setting and to serve as a contrast to the more abrasive Ellie. Pamela Austin, to note, would reappear in a few years alongside Elvis and Kiss and Cousins. Abigail serves primarily as a misdirect, meant to fill the expected role of slightly older woman who also happens to fall for Chad, an Irene Sperry of sorts.
Without walking in the moonlight. Moonlight in Hawaii can be rather intoxicating.
Yeah, I know. That's why I never touch the stuff.
I just had to talk to someone.
Well, whatever it is, this is the night for it.
Chad?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not as young as you might think I am.
Oh?
Not old. But a little older than you. Not that that should make a difference.
No, it doesn't make any difference.
You know, I've taken a vacation every summer looking for, well, romance.
But the late reveal that she's secretly fallen for the Pineapple Company's president, Jack, makes for a tidy resolution to a paper-thin subplot that allows for a little drama without needing to commit to real heartbreak, and Nancy Walters is just fine in the role. 19-year-old Jenny Maxwell had been brought to the attention of Norman Torog after he was shown an early pre-broadcast version of the Twilight Zone episode Long Distance Call, and he was impressed by her expressiveness. Already a married mother, Maxwell and Elvis didn't share any behind-the-scenes romantic flings, but their on-screen chemistry was enough to drive the marketing of the film, geared toward teenage girls who would want to be in her shoes. Ellie is an archetype of many films of the era, the bratty sex kitten who gets straightened out by the male protagonist, but most of her advances are played for laughs. The role doesn't necessarily require depth, but it does require sincerity, and Jenny Maxwell is as earnest as they come, bringing a careful emotional balance as Ellie playfully baits Chad for attention, while masking that immaturity underneath. Torog's intuition was correct, with her scowls and pouts, her expressiveness makes her one of Elvis's more memorable co-stars. Sadly, Jenny's career fizzled out, and she passed away quite young at age 39 in 1981. For years, it had been reported that she had been shot in a botched robbery, but new research published by an extended family member in 2021 revealed that the case was actually discovered to be a botched assassination attempt. A hitman hired by her husband was supposed to kill her and shoot him to make it look like a robbery. However, he ended up dying from his wound as well. An unfortunate, tragic end to a favorite of many Elvis fans.
I'll remember you.
The other bit players, Chad's beach buddies, the obnoxious tourist, Smiley's sweet grandmother, serve their roles well. And Blue Hawaii even manages to include pointless but cutesy scene involving two young kids and a trained dog, quickly becoming key elements of any family-friendly Hal Wallace Elvis Presley production. Unfortunately, we do have to talk about Ping Pong, the Gates family servant. Now, there is, sadly, a non-zero number of Elvis fans that would see critiques of this blatantly racist caricature and say, stop with the political correctness. But honestly, I'm not offended by Ping Pong. Actor Guy Lee, an outspoken advocate for Asian American actors, takes a role he knows is denigrating in stride, turns in some genuine comedic moments himself, and gives Ping Pong a presence of dignity and competence that's surely intended to contrast with Sarah Lee Gates' ignorance and elitist posturing.
Oh, Ping Pong, my eggs are cold. Take them back and warm them up, see the play.
Oui, oui, missy. Oh, morning, Mr. Chadwick.
Hi, Ping.
You want some cold eggs?
No, thanks. I'll stick to juice and coffee. Thank you.
That doesn't make it better, but Ping Pong speaks volumes about how disappointingly Blue Hawaii paints other cultures with broad brushes, especially when compared with Waikiki Wedding, a film almost 25 years its senior.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Everything okay, Missa Gate? Missy Gate just taking nap. Sevo play.
You see, when I was recapping the story of the Bing Crosby movie, I left out one key, minute-long scene that comes about two-thirds of the way through, that completely upends your understanding of the film and adds layers of depth. While Tony Marvin is taking Georgia on a roaring adventure, crossing paths with all manner of quote-unquote authentic Hawaiian culture, two of the Hawaiian citizens reveal to each other that everything happening, all the dance numbers, the mystery, the air of exoticism, is an act.
Tony got here right on schedule, eh?
Yeah, right on the dot. Say, I gotta be going. Next thing on the program is the fight. See you later.
Okay.
Why are you...
How we doing? Keep punching, you're winning.
I mean the volcano.
Not so good.
What do you mean not so good?
We need more smoke, more stuff.
Okay,
pile it on.
They're all just normal, modern people putting on a scripted show, hired by Tony Marvin and the Pineapple Company to use their heritage as crassly commercial entertainment in service of making a Midwestern lady feel like she's getting a thrilling experience so that more people from the mainland will be compelled to buy pineapples, come visit Hawaii. Oh, I also forgot to mention the Pineapple Company's name, Imperial. It's a biting social commentary that I'm sure almost no one caught and internalized in 1937. After all, like Blue Hawaii later, it's easy to be distracted by the vocal stylings of Bing Crosby and Shirley Ross, the outrageous comedy, the spectacular dance numbers, but there it is. Tourism and agriculture and the commercialization of indigenous culture intertwined to try to make a buck. As someone who grew up in a state also dominated by agriculture and tourism as the primary industries and spent the last 8 years working in tourism marketing, this really resonated with me. You grow up knowing that every summer the ignorant tourists come to see the sights, ask dumb questions, and generally just gum up the whole works for a good 6 months of the year. But you also know that it's necessary to the health of your community's economy. That infusion of cash means that the little shops and restaurants in your town, which wouldn't be able to survive year-round on local traffic alone, will make it to next year. It's intended to be another dismissive, ignorant comment, but when Sarah Lee Gates says this...
I like my job, Mom. It's fun, it's interesting, and I meet a lot of nice people.
Nonsense. Tourists aren't people. They're tourists.
That hits home so hard for people in the know. In this way, Waikiki Wedding reveals that it already understands the dilemma faced by real Hawaiians far more than Blue Hawaii ever would. Real Hawaiian history is yet another tragedy of European conquering and theft of land by wealthy plantation owners, eradication of the indigenous population by disease, the overthrow of Hawaii's own government, repression of societal and cultural structures, and the inevitable annexation by the United States. In mainland educational systems, it's not uncommon for the extent of one's education about Hawaii to start and end with, and then Hawaii became the 50th state in 1959. Knowing that Blue Hawaii was made with its setting barely in the aftermath of its newly minted statehood, a state looking to drum up interest, to help grow its economy, to help employ its citizens so they can just get by another day, another month, another year, thoroughly explains why they were so happy to roll out the red carpet and to put their best foot forward for Hollywood. It also gives the film's subtext a different weight. Waikiki Wedding could afford to let viewers in on the secret. Right at the top of the film, there's a scene of a woman working in a pineapple canning factory. But Blue Hawaii needs to make sure that you never see the men and women behind the curtain. Fred and Sara Lee Gates are clearly meant to recall the old plantation owners of the Deep South, the slave owners, and Chad Gates is there to tell us just how happening Hawaii is right now, so much so that he seems to want to reject that heritage and show us all the cool shit there is to see.
And nobody ever came up with anything better than the human hand to reach in these little leaves and break them off.
That doesn't look so tough.
Oh, no, try it.
Be careful.
Oh, it bites!
You see what I mean? These things are tricky. They're full of sharp little edges.
Can you get us a pineapple, Chad?
Oh, I think that could be arranged. Nice, cold slices of pineapple. This little stand right over here.
Pineapple?
What'd you expect? Bananas?
Chad never actually repudiates the system that gave Jack, his parents, and by extension him, their privilege. He only rejects their specific plans for his place in the business. The first place he takes Miss Prentice and the girls is to the fields of the plantation, where they can watch the pineapple pickers and try some pineapple themselves. Don't think about the demanding physical labor. Don't think about long days on your feet in the tropical weather, hands raw at the end of the workday. Don't think. We've got a hooky-lau to go to. All of this might be easier to ignore, like some Elvis fans might wish, if the script didn't use Sara Lee Gates to directly call into question the matter of race and class. Multiple times, Sara Lee calls out Chad's friends as being lazy beach boys.
Say, Momsie, how about my friends?
You mean those native boys?
They got the swingingest group in the islands.
Oh, they are not musicians, Chad. They're just beach boys.
Mom, they've turned professional. They do a lot of work around town.
Now, how'd you know that?
But then we get to Ito Eat, a song in the style of calypso, a genre more associated with the Caribbean than Polynesian culture, sang with lyrics in broken English, Ito Eat all the night and the day, reinforcing a gluttonous stereotype.
Hey, eat a little faster. Eat a little slower.
In this way, Blue Hawaii is a film that wants to have its cake and eat it too.
When you say that, strangers smile.
I want to quickly jump to another film loosely connected to Blue Hawaii before coming to my conclusions here. The 2002 Disney animated feature film Lilo and Stitch. In the film, young Elvis fan Lilo's older sister Nani, a young woman of Native Hawaiian descent, is fired from her job after Lilo's adopted pet Stitch, secretly an alien science project built for destruction, causes chaos. The resort she works at, just like we see in Blue Hawaii, offers up fire twirling, tiki torches for mood lighting, and costumed waitstaff. As she leaves, she offers this retort to her boss.
This is not working out.
But...
Mm-mm.
Yeah? Well, who wants to work at this stupid, fakey luau anyway? Come on, Lilo.
Lilo and Stitch is chock full of classic Elvis tunes. Heartbreak Hotel, Stuck on You, Suspicious Minds. But it struck me that out of the three Hawaiian-themed films and one TV special that Elvis made, the only time that the filmmakers chose to feature a Hawaii-themed Elvis song is when played in the film as distant, almost inaudible mood music at this... quote, stupid, fakey luau. The song in question, Blue Hawaii.
David, I told you, I can't. I got a lot to deal with right now.
I know. I just figured you might need some time.
You smell like a lawnmower. Look, I gotta go. The kid at table 3 is throwing poi again. Maybe some other time, okay?
Don't worry. She likes your butt and fancy hair. I know.
I read her diary.
She thinks it's fancy?
While Elvis fans were delighted and kids were distracted, myself included, by the montage of Stitch's zany antics as Lilo tries to teach him to become a model citizen like Elvis, it's easy to forget that the montage only happens because Nani is out job hunting and not having much luck. The only options for her, if you pay close attention, are just more jobs in the tourism industry. A fruit stand salesperson, a coffee shop barista, a hotel concierge, a lifeguard on a beach filled with tourists. The coffee shop owner even notes that she can't hire Nani because the tourism season just ended, before being interrupted by Stitch's kick-ass ukulele solo, of course.
Lattes with
I wish I could, Nani, but I just hired Teddy and the tour season ended.
Even here, in a lighthearted animated film, we see a fundamental truth about the real, actually authentic Hawaiian experience. Having the means to keep your little sister from being whisked away by Child Protective Services is entirely at the mercy of the whims and waves of tourists, who wash ashore for 6 months of the year for their grand adventure, and then are gone as quickly as a crest in the ocean. There's a deleted scene from Lilo and Stitch that pushes this even further. Several tourists, looking for the beach, ask her for directions, mispronouncing mahalo, assuming Lilo doesn't even speak English, and, on the beach itself, one excitedly points her out.
Oh look, a real native!
Lilo pranks the gullible tourists, getting them to think a tsunami siren test means a real threat. It's been speculated over the years that the scene might have just been a bridge too far for the Disney Corporation with its own huge stakes in the tourism industry. But I actually think it's more likely, considering the action-packed climax of the film was changed after the 9/11 terror attacks, that it's more likely the fact that Lilo half-jokingly calls the tourists terrorists that led to the scene being cut.
Now put your arms out.
Terrorists! Prepare!
Uh-huh. It's a shame, in any case, that it was left out. Blue Hawaii spends so much of its time going out of its way to appeal to middle American mainlanders that it deliberately avoids even paying lip service to the experience of living in Hawaii, of being a Hawaiian, lest the immersion be broken for the tourists. And both Chad and Miley spend a lot of dialogue reinforcing just how important tourism is for Hawaii, but always in a way that's complimentary to the potential Hawaiian visitor.
Yes, you do. Hey, I'm Carver. I am a tourist from Chillicothe, Ohio, and I want to see some night-blooming cereus blossoms. Where would you take me?
I would take you to the Punahou School.
The Punahou? You would? That is good. Yes. That's splendid. This young man knows, Miss Duval.
I've spent so much time in this video examining this because I think it's important in understanding where Blue Hawaii fits in, not just in Elvis's filmography, but in culture at large. Waikiki Wedding and Lilo and Stitch both recognize the commercialization of Hawaiian culture as a necessary evil, an adaptation for economic survival. But Blue Hawaii revels in it, happily imposing European sensibilities onto an Hawaiian aesthetic, down to the most irrefutably appealing factor, the music. Even its best songs, No More and Can't Help Falling in Love, are Spanish and French in origin. Even Aloha Oi, the only song to appear in all three films, the most famous Hawaiian song there is, has culturally complex melodic origins dating back to a German iteration of an English folk tune called The Lone Rock by the Sea, the result of the songwriter, Hawaiian Princess Lili Ukulani, having internalized musical influence with her close friend, German bandleader Henry Berger. By the mid-1960s and into the 1970s, Hawaii was undergoing a movement to restore a sense of pride in Hawaiians who had struggled with their self-identity, since so many Hawaiians were now, like Miley, culturally and racially mixed, descended as much from European imperialists as from Asian immigrants and indigenous Hawaiians. After all, how do tens of thousands of Hawaiian workers reckon with their own participation in the commercialization of their culture just to keep the lights on? Writer John Dominus Holt, a prominent figure of this Hawaiian Renaissance, in his essay On Being Hawaiian, describes an encounter with what can only be described as a real-life Sarah Lee Gates. Quote, "Statistically, I am part Hawaiian, although I was reminded one night at a dinner party by a charming, mathematically astute lady who descends from two prominent early missionary couples that I am actually 3/8 Hawaiian by blood." End quote. Holt goes on to detail his genealogy before ending with a reaffirmation of his identity, stating, quote, "I am, in depth, a product of Hawaii, an American, yes, who is a citizen of the 50th state, but I am also a Hawaiian, somewhat by blood, and in large measure by sentiment. Of this, I am proud." End quote. By virtue of its setting, its premise, its characters, the contents of its script, its massive popularity, and its place in the arc of American history, not just pop culture, Blue Hawaii is, unlike so many other Elvis films before and after, inseparable from the topics of race, class, economics, shared cultures, and changing sexual mores. To simply say, you're not supposed to think about it, just enjoy it, is to rob Blue Hawaii of its weight as a work of art, of the discussions that it can foster about the time and place of its creation, its standing within Elvis's film career, and closes us off to insight into how America viewed Hawaii, as both a part of and a part outside the American experience in the wake of its statehood.
Gang, let's go. Hooky Lau.
Who needs group fishing? That's hokey.
If you don't pull the net, you don't eat the fish. That's Hooky Lau. Let's go.
To enjoy Blue Hawaii for exactly what it sets out to be is, at the end of the day, nothing to be ashamed of or embarrassed by. But taking it up on the invitations the film offers to examine its cultural context more deeply can only give you greater appreciation for how remarkable it is that it turned out as entertaining as it is. Blue Hawaii is a stupid, fakey luau, and yet it is absolutely worth experiencing. And hey, at least he sings.
Ooh, baby, take my hand. We'll have some real rockin' fun in the sun. Slash and sand. We'll have some real rockin' fun in the sun.
Slash and sand.
You boys forgot your part over there just a little bit.
The soundtrack for Blue Hawaii was recorded over a three-day period near the end of March 1961. And to give the music a more stereotypically Hawaiian feel, producer Joseph Lilly invited famed pioneer steel guitarist Alvino Ray and Hawaiian vocal group The Surfers to perform the Hawaiian lyric tunes, where Elvis's longtime collaborators The Jordanaires would back him up on the more traditional rock and pop material. As mentioned previously, Blue Hawaii featured the highest density of musical performances ever seen in a movie starring Elvis, but it also came equipped with songs that, if not progressed the narrative, at least elaborated on character beats more in the vein of a traditional Broadway musical. This was something new for Elvis. Blue Hawaii committed to the conceits of a musical more in a way that would not be seen again in his movies until 1963's Kissin' Cousins, and I think this might be the singular reason why the film was as successful as it was. The movie-going public was still incredibly receptive to the musical in the 1960s, a decade which provided some of the greatest cinematic Broadway adaptations in decades. Hello, Dolly, Thoroughly Modern Millie, The Sound of Music, My Fair Lady, Bye Bye Birdie, The Music Man, and of course, West Side Story, which released a mere month before Blue Hawaii and swept the Academy Awards, including winning Best Picture, and it should be noted, might have actually replaced Blue Hawaii as an Elvis film. You see, West Side Story director Robert Wise's first choice for the lead role of Tony was Elvis, a vote of confidence in Elvis's capabilities as an actor and singer that neither Hal Wallace nor Colonel Parker could ever match or appreciate. There were too many reasons to say no in Parker's mind, though. Elvis's pay would take a cut, his screen time would be diminished, Elvis wouldn't get a cut of the music publishing, it would take too long to make the film, and worst of all, the artistry would come first. It's hard telling what West Side Story might have looked like with Elvis. Both with and without Colonel Parker at his side, would it have been the artistic powerhouse that it was, with the Colonel hawking pennants with Elvis and Natalie Wood's faces on them at the premiere? How would have Elvis risen to the challenge, the demand to be fully present physically and emotionally in every scene? For the first time in his career, to be a part of something bigger than himself. Rather than having the specter of expectation looming over him, those same expectations that made rock critics like Peter Guralnick dismiss Blue Hawaii as a trivialization of his music, a repudiation of his commitment to rock and roll. Would Guralnick have written that same ridiculous critique of Leonard Bernstein's iconic, culturally significant musical score if, instead of vocalist Jimmy Bryant, it was Elvis Presley's voice unleashing the high notes of Something's Coming and Maria?
The most beautiful song I ever heard, Maria.
A whopping 15 songs were recorded by Elvis for Blue Hawaii. One was cut during filming, and we know of at least two others considered for the film late into production. Let's take a look at them all. Elvis's cover of Blue Hawaii, set to the opening titles in a montage of Hawaiian scenery, would not have been imaginable even 2 years earlier. Elvis brings to it the warmth of a crooner like Bing Crosby or Dean Martin, with controlled vibrato and a sense of confidence not present on his 50s recordings. Gone is the awkward, squeaky-voiced young man. Listen to his jump on the last two notes, the words, "with you." It's clean, it's pure. And the film version features additional orchestration that makes it feel sweeping, cinematic.
This magic night of nights with you.
The first song, sung by Chad to Miley on screen in the film, Almost Always True, is an adaptation of the French-Canadian song Alouette, and immediately Norman Torog nails the key factor of any car-driving song scene by putting Elvis in the passenger seat, where Joan Blackman can play the straight woman to his wild-eyed teasing. Elvis gets to snap his fingers, clap, play with props, and make faces, adding a charm that's completely missed in Wild in the Country, and shows the audience that despite his wandering eyes, Chad really is a lovable goofball.
Though my arm was twisted, I was almost always true to you.
While the couple swims, Chad's Beach Boy friends paddle into the scene, introducing us to Aloha Oi, performed by the surfers. Elvis tackles the Hawaiian lyrics sincerely, but narratively it doesn't quite make sense for them to be singing a song deliberately written as a farewell. It's more intended to establish the Hawaiian-ness of the setting, seeing as how it is the most famous Hawaiian song.
We meet again until we meet.
This is immediately followed up by a slap dance routine, a comedic relief bit, reminiscent of genuine Samoan slap dances, but with a modern punchline unexpectedly throwing in the riff, "Shave and a haircut, two bits." This was also recorded by the Surfers and was penned by Charles O'Curran and Hollywood pianist Dudley Brooks, who often served as Elvis's rehearsal pianist and arranger, a duo that would go on to write "We'll Be Together" for Elvis and "Girls, Girls, Girls." Prompted to regale his friends about his romantic endeavors overseas, Chad dives into No More, an adaptation of the Spanish song La Paloma, backed up by the Jordanaires. The song doesn't add much to the plot, but it's very much in keeping with the European-style ballads like It's Now or Never and Surrender that Elvis was releasing on his non-soundtrack material, and he would go on to revisit it in a series of late-night recordings as additional content for the American broadcast of the 1973 TV special Aloha from Hawaii.
We belong together. Come to me. Let's be sweethearts again, and then let us part no more.
Okay. When Chad arrives at Miley's grandmother's birthday party, his friends are putting on a show with a female dancer, and we get an extended musical reprise of their slap dance song before they all close in on Miley's grandmother to celebrate her. Chad brings the gift of a music box that plays the melody to the French ballad Plaisir d'Amour. What follows is a touching, intimate performance of a song called Can't Help Falling in Love, in which Chad uses singing to Miley's grandmother as a means of expressing all the things he can't bring himself to tell Miley in so many words.
Wise men say only fools rush in, but I can't help falling in love with you.
I'm aware that this scene has been criticized as being boring, that it was a waste of an iconic, memorable song being sung to an elderly lady who just sort of sits there awkwardly and smiles, but that criticism misses the point and tries to take the song outside of its original context as a song serving the narrative of the film. Chad and Miley talk about settling down and getting married, sure, but without fail, he always runs off, inspired by some other idea, as soon as it starts getting close to the mark. And yet, there's an underlying, to be fair, sometimes overt, theme of marriage in several of the songs he sings to her. There's an unspoken story here in how Miley's grandfather is nowhere to be seen in the film. By how many friends and family are at the party, clearly this woman has lived a full life, is loved and adored by those who know her. When Chad and Miley can't stop taking their eyes off each other, her grandmother notices and recognizes in this moment that when Chad is singing, "Take my hand, take my whole life too," this is the marriage proposal that Miley has been waiting for. I do think so often that Can't Help Falling in Love became almost too popular. It became Elvis's signature song, the song he performed the most. It's the one that's resonated across generations, across racial, social, cultural, economic lines. The song has so much baggage, but here, as a sincere moment between a character who's always joking and deflecting and the woman he can't help falling in love with, over and over, it's absolutely as magical as it's intended, if you allow it to be. Later, at Chad's welcome home party, the band kicks in with Rockahoola Baby as a means of rescuing Miley from Sara Lee, and it contrasts the uptight, high-class guest of the party with the loud rock and roll rhythms of the youth. Miley even gets in on the choreography, and its big bluesy ending provides the perfect cover for our hero's hasty exit.
Rockahoola Baby, Rockahoola Baby, got a hula loop from the Honolulu down to Rockahoola Baby of mine.
Rock in the way rock critics conventionally think of it, especially compared to Jailhouse Rock's title track. But in 1961, when the hardest things hitting the charts were Chubby Checker's Pony Time and Bobby Lewis's Tossin' and Turnin', Rockahoola Baby gets the point across in this sequence just fine. Off on their tour of Hawaii and on their way to the pineapple fields, Chad, Abigail, and the group of young women sing Moonlight Swim. Chad's in the driver's seat, and you can immediately sense Elvis's discomfort singing while having to keep an eye on the road. But the women's harmonizing helps brighten the mood, and the use of the scene to show how excited all but one of the characters are just to be there helps keep the plot moving forward. Interestingly, Moonlight Swim was not written for the film, but had come out on two competing singles in 1957 by Nick Noble and Tony Perkins. So that knowledge can even excuse the plot hole of how the women would know the lyrics to the song to join in. Maybe they heard it. It's one of the weaker musical sequences in the film, rescued by some nice harmonies and a smooth vocal turn from Elvis. It's worth mentioning that at this point of the film, we're reaching about the one-hour mark, with 8 song and dance numbers under our belt. And the Hukilau presents perhaps the film's most dense musical sequences, with 3 songs nearly back-to-back-to-back. Ku'u'ipo, Ito Eats, and Slice and Sand. The first is maybe the weakest visually, as Chad wanders listlessly through the group of women as they wait for the hukilau to get underway, plunking away on a ukulele, but it too offers that theme of marriage as he sings these lyrics to Miley.
As the years go passing by, we'll recall our wedding day.
Ito Eats is a song that could only work in the context of the film, paying off the running gag of Chad's voracious Hawaiian friend Ito, although, as mentioned before, the Calypso beat reflects that Wallace and Torog weren't looking for genuine Hawaiian tradition, but instead the stereotypically tropical. But it's fun enough.
Slice some sand.
Take off your shoes, pull it down your hair. Turn on the music and we'll get somewhere. Dance, dance, dance till your toes get tanned. We're gonna have us a ball in the beach.
It's the last of the three, Slice and Sand, where Blue Hawaii reaches the pinnacle of its have its cake and eat it to indulgence. The song gets two words of introduction, Slice and Sand, and they're off. It's insane. It should be annoying, but it's a fully choreographed number. Everyone involved is absolutely committed. Elvis strikes poses that done by anyone else would look ridiculous, but he manages to make it cool. It even stays narratively consistent. Eagle-eyed viewers will catch Ellie rolling her eyes and walking away during the musical intro. It's never drawn to your attention, but it's a detail of blocking consistent with her character that they could have easily missed or skipped over, especially considering there is a continuity error where Chad and Miley swap places. But honestly, for 1 minute, 37 seconds, this film is firing on all cylinders. It's undeniable. It is a stupid fakey luau, and goddammit if I don't want in.
We'll have some real rock and roll in the sun. Stars and sand.
Speaking of luaus, Chad does perform Hawaiian Sunset at a luau that they attend, and man, is that a snooze fest. It's at this point that I have to mention that the fact that Chad is a fantastic musician, the idea of him ever capitalizing on his talents, never comes up in the plot, not once. That's how committed this film is to cinematic tourism. The guy really wants to be a tour guide, even if it makes more sense for him to become the biggest headliner on the islands. In an attempt to disrupt Ellie's flirtation with a lecherous old tourist, Mr. Garvey, Chad pulls her out onto the dance floor, and it's here, with one line of dialogue that she's stepping out of line, that we're cued in as to where the first deleted song would have come in.
You're gonna dance, Richie. Come on.
I know you're stepping out of line.
That's my business.
My business, too.
Elvis fans didn't have to wait long to hear Steppin' Out of Line, though, as it appeared on his next regular studio album, Potluck. And the lyrics make so much more sense when knowing it's intended to be directed at the character of Ellie at this point in the plot. Elvis turns in a pretty intense delivery, with Chad sternly rebuking her.
Well, listen, little lady, you're stepping out of line. Oh, watch your hurry, baby. You got a lot of time. Not a love you feel, it's only make-believe. Watch out, you'll break the heart you're wearing on your sleeve. Cheating with your kisses.
I'm sure this would have been a really incredible choreographed sequence. Musically, we get a great sax solo from Boots Randolph. But alas, this was apparently the point at which Norman Torog said, okay, maybe we've gone too far. It is unusual for songs that get cut to make it past the point of Elvis recording them. But it was far more common for multiple song concepts from different songwriters to be considered for scenes, leaving the choice of which to go with up to Elvis. And for this scene with Ellie, we do know from documentation uncovered by fans and collectors that Elvis had a choice between Steppin' Out of Line and another Fred Wise and Ben Wiseman penned song called Playing with Fire. Usually, though, the rejected songs were left unrecorded or slightly rewritten for consideration on a later film, such is the case with I'm Yours, which was submitted for Blue Hawaii, but Elvis ended up recording for Potluck as well.
My love, I offer you now. My heart and all it can give. For just as long as I live. I'm yours.
But in the case of Playing with Fire, it was actually recorded by Terry Stafford, a pop singer with a slight vocal resemblance to Elvis, who actually managed to have his version of Suspicion hit number one in 1964, beating out Elvis's version and even charting over the earliest hits by the Beatles. Terry's version of Playing with Fire is enlightening because the sentiments of the song are very consistent with Stepping Out of Line, as Chad would have told Ellie that she's too young, thinks this is all for fun. It is rare that we get to hear finalized versions of songs meant for Elvis's films, recorded by other artists, and yet still retaining the heart of their narrative purpose, and it's an interesting alternate Blue Hawaii that we can play out in our heads. But back in the film itself, a fight simply breaks out instead, and Chad ends up in the local jail with his friends, bemoaning his Beach Boy blues. And here again, it is another song that could only work in the type of story-driven musical Blue Hawaii is going for. Lines like this...
Just like the pig before he gave his all at the luau, I'm in a pen.
Are completely ridiculous, and yet here they are, coming out of the mouth of the so-called king of rock and roll, who is absolutely mugging it up on camera. A song like this is not beneath him. It's a testament to his artistic elasticity. If Can't Help Falling in Love is Blue Hawaii's One Hand, One Heart, then this is Blue Hawaii's G. Officer Krupke. Expectations be damned, they're capable of coexisting. By the time we get to Island of Love, though, the film is getting a little long in the tooth, musically speaking, really only offering this up as an excuse to explore the island of Kauai. And even the harmonizing by the female backing singers can't make this more engaging on its own 2 feet, but as part of the complete package, it's mood music, it's fine. And finally, after resolving all the romantic subplots, the overarching conflict between Chad and his parents, Miley and Chad are finally married, and we get the finale, Hawaiian Wedding Song. It's a grand Technicolor spectacle, and although it wasn't written for the film, it was a song that Elvis personally liked, and he would go on to revisit throughout his career, not just in the Aloha special, but even as late as his final concerts, a version appearing in the 1977 album Elvis in Concert.
Skies of Hawaii smile on this our wedding day. I do love you.
In closing, Blue Hawaii as a film and accompanying soundtrack was, by every meaningful metric, a runaway success. The soundtrack album was on the Billboard Top Albums chart for 79 weeks, number one for 20. The film was the second highest earning musical that year, behind only West Side Story. And although the album didn't commit to the true soundtrack format, leaving off the vocals by other in-film characters and the cinematic overdubs, to its credit, RCA sequenced the tracks correctly, as they appeared in the film. Even critics recognized the movie for its breezy intent and judged it accordingly. It's not one of Elvis's best films, but it is one of the most entertaining, and certainly among the most culturally interesting. Jailhouse Rock has often been cited as the best, the more valuable, the most, quote, culturally, aesthetically, or historically significant, end quote, while this film is dismissed as the moment in which the cycle and formula of the Elvis movie solidified, and Elvis became stuck. Blue Hawaii seems brainless at first glance, but it raises interesting questions and perspectives, both in its text and its subtext, about class, race, changing sexual mores, the sharing of cultures, about America, about Hawaii, about how we view Elvis Presley. Don't think about it, some Elvis fans will say. It's an Elvis movie. Just sit back and enjoy. But if you do think about it, Jailhouse Rock fails to actually say much about anything it uses to prop up its story. The American prison system, the music publishing and recording industry, the pitfalls of fame. Vince Everett is an angry, snarky young man, rebelling against what exactly? A system he hypocritically becomes complicit in the moment it's financially beneficial for him?
We got an offer for the label, Peg. It's just too good to turn down.
An offer? What kind of an offer?
To sell out to Geneva Records. Wait a minute. What year the deal? $750,000, a capital gain. That's $225,000 in cold cash for you after taxes.
But, Vince, I don't want to sell out.
I'm afraid you got no choice, kid.
I know 60%.
That's the way the mob flops.
If the most critically acclaimed Elvis Presley film depicts the symbolic rebel Elvis as a hypocrite, where does that leave Chad Gates, the model citizen? There's a sequence on the beach in Lilo and Stitch, where in the span of a minute, Stitch appears in an Elvis wig and jumpsuit, becomes a rock star, the subject of fame and adoration, and then is suddenly crowded and overwhelmed, so much that his destructive nature takes over. Amid the wreckage, Lilo throws away her picture of Elvis. A promo photo of Elvis as Chad Gates, the reality of Stitch's Elvis, the model citizen, did not live up to her expectations. And yet, that moment with Stitch is such a beautiful, sympathetic microcosm of Elvis's life, the real Elvis. That night, knowing all might be lost and Lilo might be taken away from her, Nani expresses her grief and her love in a way that's the same in any language. She sings.
One fond embrace, Ahoia, until we meet again.
Well, we're probably sore. I actually slept up to the studio mostly. But you can rest assured that it'll be music in almost all of them.
Writer Susan Freeland once said that, quote, art begets art. Painting feeds the eye just as poetry feeds the ear, which is to say that both feed the soul, end quote. Blue Hawaii, the film, and the soundtrack were art, food for the soul. And if we had had neither, how many first dances to Can't Help Falling in Love would we have lost? How many tourists did it inspire to travel to Hawaii over the last 60 years? To see the sights, to walk the same paths as Elvis, to participate in the cultural and agricultural industries of Hawaii, keeping the economy rolling another year. What would Lilo and Stitch even be without Blue Hawaii there first? Can we even imagine the rest of the life of Elvis Presley without Blue Hawaii? Without Can't Help Falling in Love?
So it goes. Some things are meant to be.
Some things are meant to be. It wasn't meant to be, but Blue Hawaii was, for better, for worse, the most important movie Elvis Presley ever made. The video essay version of this review was dedicated to the memory of pianist Dudley Brooks, who played the Celeste on the film version of Can't Help Falling in Love. The podcast version of this review is also dedicated to the memory of Jennifer Helene Maxwell, who passed away tragically 40 years ago this year.
You've been listening to the TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis fan podcast. Justin Gossman and Gurdeep Ladar have left the building.
Someone must have stomped on his head with those blue suede shoes.
Thank you and good night.